We're going to start our keynote luncheon presentation. And I'd like to start off by thanking URSA Resources for sponsoring your lunch and our keynote presenter today. Our presenter is David Ropeek. He is a consultant in risk perception and risk communication. He's also an instructor at Harvard University. And he will be speaking to us today about the risk perception gap, why our fears don't always match the facts. And I hope you find this very meaningful and instructive, because certainly when we're dealing with oil and gas, risk is something that is at the fore of most discussions.
Howdy.
Howdy, partner.
Take Mr. Jolly's hat back now.
I think I'll keep it.
It's all right, you can keep it. Surprise and fit.
Now.
Yes.
Here you go. So yeah, I'm not a behind the podium guy either. And I'm not a Harvard guy. Let's dispel this right away. So here's who I am, so you can judge for yourself what I have to offer. I was a TV reporter for 25 years, and I saw what I'm about to talk to you about all the time in the news stories that I reported, where I'd interview somebody, and they'd be screaming afraid of something. And then I'd interview the expert, and they would say, what's the big deal? Right? The fears are too high. Or I'd interview people who were crazy afraid of this, but the thing they should be afraid of, they weren't. Quick example, Ebola and influenza. Think America got that one wrong? Okay, so I saw that all the time, and I started to study up on and even report on the psychology of why that happens, which is relevant to y'all, which is why I'm here. And I then left TV News because TV News got to be really dumb. It was dumb before, but it got to be Britney Spears is pregnant again. Back to you in the studio. So I got out of that because that wasn't public service anymore. And I joined the Harvard School of Public Health, where I got to study more of this and teach more of this. And now I go around as an independent consultant helping organizations and companies and governments deal with risk issues where there's lots of emotions, so that if you understand those emotions and the importance of those emotions, you can work on task forces better and make more progress. I teach one class at Harvard, so you all people think I'm from Harvard, but I'm not. Okay. Define the word. Oh, so this is going to be interactive. I'm going to ask you questions as we go so that you realize I'm not talking about them out there. I'm talking about me and you and us. The stuff I'm talking about, the psychology that explains why the facts alone are not how afraid we are, it's in all of us. Define the word risk, doctor. Sorry, let me rephrase my question. Define it in a high school definition sort of way. The word risk means?
Risk means something that has the potential to create harm.
Bingo, awesome, saved me a lot of things. Is there any engineers or risk assessors here? Risk assessment people? So, do you know what the risk assessment definition of risk is? Okay, so let me just to move things on. That's the dictionary definition. You're close to the scientific one. The scientific one is hazard times exposure equals consequence. So in hazard, you got what's the thing and what's the dose and all of those sorts of things. And in exposure, you got how much do I breathe in or eat in or whatever and at what age, all that science. And that comes up with the likelihood of a bad thing happening to you. Now we'll go over to the real world definition, however, which is the likelihood of something bad happening, if I can paraphrase what you said. The chance, the probability. You know, think about risk as the number, right? The one in a million, right? That's what the scientists give us. That's what your studies will give you, kind of. Epidemiology, you know, is a shaky base even when you have great data. But they're only giving you the first half of the definition. The definition of risk to you and me and all the people who deal with every risk issue out there, hydraulic fracking or driving a car with a cell phone, is the probability from the sciences of something bad happening. Mr. Lepore is chewing, so I'll ask you, what's bad mean? And where do you live?
Here in Rifle.
Here in Rifle. So now let me just change slides. Watch this. Ready? Bad. So the definition of risk is risk, right? The chance that something bad could happen. Chance is calculable, knowable scientifically. Bad is a feeling, right? So out here, if you saw that, what would you think? What's your emotional reaction to that picture? Where are the WPX people? You're loving it, huh? Nice clean pad, huh? Right? But if you saw that in Boulder, what would you think? Can you hear me?
Wait.
It's making a bad noise.
I know it's making. Can you hear me? Can you hear me?
It's got to be that for the camera. Okay, I'm a singer. Moon River.
So if they saw that in Boulder, how would they feel? Or any of the communities that have problems. Now let's change it. Now how do you feel? Do you have an emotional reaction to that picture?
Oh, that's not facts, is it? That's where you sit. That's who you are. That's feelings. So that's my first,
That's my first message and my most important message. And I'll go into the details of where those feelings come from in a minute. But the first message here is that our perceptions of everything in the world, and I'm only talking about risk, your blue shirt, what you had for lunch, is subjective. You take the information that it represents and you then subconsciously figure out how you feel about it. Knocks and socks and snow and trees and all the details that go into ozone. How do I feel about that? Is what matters for how people react, behave, change, choose, vote. So that's what you have to understand because it's the, I would argue, suggest, offer. Because if you understand, A, that the issue you're dealing with isn't just about everybody understanding the data, but how they feel about it, now you can start to engage them, even if you're at battle, in a more respectful conversation because you know it's not just about, hey, here are my facts now. Now you know my facts, so you're wrong and stupid if you disagree with me, which is essentially the message that a lot of education campaigns have. So I love this quote. It'll help you remember what I'm talking about. We think we're pretty smart. Humans, we think we're pretty smart, right? We have this brain and we're more evolved than other species. We are simply not as consciously, objectively rational thinkers as we think we are. We are mostly still, no offense, animals working on the basic biological instincts that drive most of what we do, with the layer of all of the cognitive work that your task force also puts in. Yeah, we do that too. Let me just give you a quick example. See, my hands are a little bit cold. My hand's colder than yours?
Yep, I think so.
There's a study that says that if he was interviewing me for a job, just the fact that my hand was colder than his reduces my chance of getting the job by 20%. Is he thinking about that? No, but is that a signal? All kinds of stuff happens subconsciously, including the emotions that are involved in your issue. So now I'm going to race through a simple introduction to what, as a journalist, I've discovered in four different fields of scientific research that help explain why our fears sometimes are greater or lesser than what the evidence says. Okay? And what I want you to note here is, and I'll go through them each one at a time, what the word says, the red word, it's subconscious. Again, we think we're thinkers and decision makers and cognitive, conscious, purposeful figure-outers, but the stuff I'm about to go through, the first four of five categories, is all behind the scenes. It's that stuff. All right? So now the first thing I want to explain is how the brain does fear. Fear is a loaded word, but worry is a version of fear, right? So it's the literal brain functioning. If you see a snake and you jump back, right? So let's say this conference has an award every year. What do you have rattlesnakes out here, right? Mm-hmm. What else poisonous? Anybody ever, spiders. So anybody ever hear the green mamba snake? You know what that is? And it's in Africa, and it's also called the three-step snake, because if it bites you, that's all you got left. Yeah, I gave this talk once, and I asked some, I'm joking about the snake, and the guy raises his hand. He says, yeah, I know about the black mamba. It killed my dog who was trying to protect me in Tanzania. Felt like a jerk, but yeah, it's a real deadly snake. It's also about 6 feet long.
could stand up on its tail and bite you in the face. So let's say you won the lottery prize here, which is a free week trip to the oil and gas exploration in East Africa, right? And you're on the trip, right? And you see this. Were you looking? What did you see it? What would you do? Kirby? Jump? Pick it up, huh? Pick it up. All right, so would you come up here?
Bill.
I want you to meet Bill, because this is his last day on Earth. So here's the problem. This is the way the brain works. I'm sorry, can you all see some slides? I won't point the pointer, I'll describe them. So there's the outer wrinkly part that we think of as the brain, but it's really, that's just the layer on top. It's kind of thin. It's the cortex where we do, among other things, our purposeful thinking, okay? This is how fear works. The second area that you need to know about is this place called the thalamus down in the middle, which, for the purposes of this exercise, does two things. It's the first place a stimulus goes, like seeing me move and hearing it, before it goes to the auditory part that translates the words, or the visual part in the back of the brain that consciously makes you aware you're seeing the guy. It goes to the thalamus. So do memories. If I asked you what you had for breakfast this morning, you'd remember it, and before it would become a conscious memory, it would go to the thalamus. So it's the first place data go, and it's a relay station. It's hardwired, connected to send that data. It doesn't turn it into consciousness, sends it on to certain specific places, okay? And the third part that really matters for fear is the amygdala. I'm curious, raise your hand if you've ever heard of the amygdala. You really want a couple of these. There was a right one and a left one. You apparently don't have one. You picked up the snake. But we'll get to you in a minute, all right? The amygdala is where, and we don't know exactly how, but we know even which sections of the amygdala emotions start. So if the amygdala gets information from the thalamus and any place else, it assesses it for whether it might be scary or involve other emotions, but I'm just talking about the scary. And depending on how it assesses it, and the scientists, I don't know if you can see it on the slide, but I'm quoting the scientist whose work this is. He's reviewed my slides to make sure I'm doing it justice. Somehow the amygdala knows it's scary or not. And if it senses it's scary, it tells you to jump back, right? You didn't look to see if there was a green mamba behind you, though, did you?
Nope.
Oops, right? So, yeah, it's a stick. Let's give it up for Bill. Except, suppose he was wrong, and this is the important thing, and it's, I joke to be entertaining, but the important thing is your strategy would not make babies, and your strategy would not get passed on into the species. So the strategy we've learned is the other one, Kirby's. Get the hell out of the way and then take the extra time to think about it. Right? Okay. So this is what happens, right? The visual thing goes up the eyeball, but it could be any stimulus. It gets to that first place it gets to. The thalamus says, I'm going to send this on to a couple places. I've highlighted just a couple, the amygdala where fear starts, and the prefrontal cortex, that blue part, the part behind your forehead. That's where like COOs and CEOs do all that cognitive stuff you did. The purposeful conscious thinking part. Well, that's information traveling at exactly the same speed. Where does it get to first, where we think or where we fear? Hello? Now, try to undo that with a good public relations campaign or a great website. Right? This is why I go into these details. Here's the headline. We are hardwired in a healthy brain to feel first and think second. So are you going to succeed if you're just perfectly here, the facts rational in your interactions with anybody, especially if there are already emotions going on? No, cause of the brain. So the hardwired way the brain makes information work. And then, so the amygdala goes, jump back, right? Your heart races, all those changes happen. And then what happens, is the slides go blank and Kirby goes and fixes it. By the way, do any of you wear those Fitbit things, that measure how many steps you take? Maybe that's just an East Coast. You wear them? Yeah, it's a healthy thing, you know? I'm thinking he ought to get paid that way, right? For all the walking around he's done. While he's working on it, let me explain what the slide would show. there are lots of red lines going out of the amygdala saying, react with emotion, effectively. That's pretty close. Good job. Thank you. It's a Mac. He might not be familiar with Mac, but you did good. Thank you, sir. And 15, 16, 17 extra steps. So the red lines are signals from the amygdala that are based on a kind of instinctive feeling sort of response, right? The response. And the blue lines are, hey, the cortex. I'm the thinking part of our brain. I'm smart. Here are the facts. I just read the website. I just visited a well pad. I can see how they're done. Now I have the facts. Count up the lines. The blue lines are facts and reason and objectivity, and the red lines are emotion. Which one wins? And this is a very crude, simple, but accurate depiction of the realities of your brain. So the second biology headline, and then the biology part's going to be over, is, the first one was, we're hardwired to react with emotion first and reason and conscious thinking second, just in terms of time. But then over time, we're hardwired such that emotions count more than the facts, even when you have them all and have had all the time you need to think them through. I'm back to the beginning, the definition of risk, the probability, the facts, of something bad, how do I feel about it happening? This is how the brain works. We can't undo this. This is what's going on in the human animal of you and whoever else is across the table from you on any of these issues. Needs to be respected. Second area of science, research. Boy, they've made terrific discoveries in the last 15, 20 years about how decision-making works, judgments, choices we make, any little choice. The academics use fancy words, so I use their words, and then I knock them for using fancy words. Heuristics and biases largely mean this. We have developed a whole bunch of mental shortcuts to quickly come up with decisions. We did this for two reasons. As we turned into these modern humans that we are, in a more early stage, what worked better was, because we didn't have the fancy cortex that we modern humans do, we needed to be able to make sense of partial information in a hurry, right? And even over time, you know, 30, 20, 15, 10, 5,000 years ago, we didn't have a chance to do air quality studies, right? We weren't going to have all the information. So we had to develop instinctive kind of decision-making tools that help us make sense of partial information pretty quickly. So that's what these things are. And let me give you an example of it so you understand with your issue there highlighted. So here's one. It's called representativeness. Again, academic words, but it's a pretty simple idea. What it means is it's 1:15. So at 1 o'clock, I've asked a professional athlete to join us in the room. Is that person bigger than you, the same size, or smaller? Young lady with the black vest there, with her hand on her chin. Yeah, go ahead. Bigger, bigger, bigger. Who votes for bigger than me? Yeah, who votes for the same size as me? And who votes for that professional athlete that's going to walk in and I'm going to be bigger than him or her? Would you stand up, please? And then we'll take a vote on whether you think he's going to be right or wrong. Usually it's some 6'9" dude, you know? Right. Thank you. You didn't have all the information, did you? You had two clues. What were they? Professional and athlete, right? I didn't say some kid from some little local soccer team, right? Professional and athlete. So what you did was you want, me, asked you to make sense of partial information quickly. So you opened up the filing cabinets of what those clues represent. That's why they call it this, representative. You could call this stereotyping. You could call this judging a book by its cover. It's the same thing. But do you see what's happening? It was subconscious. You didn't nobody asked me, tell me more about the athlete, what sport, you know. You didn't have all the information. You judged it quickly. Well, now if I go out to certain communities and I use the word drilling, what's going to happen? They're going to use representativeness bias to come up with an instant, first, mostly emotional reaction to what we're then going to be talking about. That emotion's going to be the baseline from where the conversation goes. Pipelines. Depends on who you talk to. But regardless, without any more information, what kind? What's it carrying? Is it go over water? Is it underground? Is it in seismic territory? You don't have all that. You're going to have a representativeness kind of a response. Oil and gas. Well, I live in liberal Massachusetts and liberal Concord in liberal Massachusetts. And if I say any of those words and say I'm for them, I'm kicked out of my church. I have ex-friends, because I have tried simply to be evidence-based about fracking, about nuclear power, about genetically modified foods, about industrial chemicals and pesticides, all of which, in part, have been stigmatized by Gasland and other movies, your particular issue, right? And so now representativeness bias is partly what you're dealing with in your communities. Do you see how knowing this allows you to treat the people you're dealing with more respect? A little less frustration, I hope. Because they can't help it. They're not doing it on purpose. They're not even in control of it. It's part of how the human animal, including us, processes information. Understanding that helps you interact with them more respectfully and hopefully more productively. So here's a third area that I want to go into in a little bit more depth. In the late 1970s and early 80s, the oil and gas and chemical industries and the nuclear industry and their regulators in Washington, D.C. were getting really frustrated by people's fears of all those issues, environmental issues, far exceeding the actual danger. There are dangers in all of them. The fear among some people were far above what the evidence suggested. And it was driving both the industry people and the regulators nuts, kind of like your issue is a little bit now. So they asked psychologists like Paul Slovic, who's my mentor, and a whole bunch of other people, to figure out why people's fears didn't match the facts, what I'm here talking to you about. And this was the beginning of the study of the psychology of risk perception, as it's called. These other fields kind of came along later and add in. Subconsciously, the amygdala somehow can sense the personality traits, the psychological characteristics of a situation that go into its judgment, man, on the spot, of whether that feels scary or not. Let me go through a few of them that are relevant to your field. Now, two things about these. I'm going to mention these one at a time. I can only put up one at a time and talk about one at a time. But for any risk issue, there's going to be a whole lot of these emotional characteristics that come into play, and some are going to make people feel more afraid, and the same person, maybe for some, would feel less afraid. So it's a complicated mix. This psychological language alone, and this psychological language plays into all those other heuristics and biases like representativeness, and there's a whole bunch more of those. I can't go into all of them. It's a complicated soup. Don't take this as a one-off, each one of these things that I'm talking about. And also, I want you to think of each of these factors I'm talking about here as kind of like the fulcrum in a seesaw. So when I say trust, it's like the point that the seesaw is riding on. And the seesaw is how people feel, more or less. So the factor is the fulcrum. Trust. The more people trust you, the more influence you'll have on them, and the more worried or defensive or cautious they'll be. All right? So there are lots of different factors that go into trust. Trust is a whole long day of training if you really want to get into the details, but here are the headlines. Trust in who is responsible for the risk. Well, in the issue that you're dealing with, that's you guys, right? That's the companies. You're doing the work that's either causing or not causing harm. Do I trust oil and gas companies? Well, you remember what I said about representativeness bias? You ask a lot of Americans, do they trust oil and gas companies? You're in a trust hole before you open your mouth. For right or wrong, I'm not making any judgments. I'm completely neutral on the issue, right? But you got to know that, because that's part of managing your relationship with these folks. Who's responsible for protecting us? You guys want to stand up? Well, it'd be the doctor mostly, right? You trust the state agency that's supposed to protect you from whatever, or the local agency, or your county commissioner, whoever. You'll be less afraid of that thing. The data can come in exactly the same, and if there's higher trust, people will be less afraid. And if there's less trust, which comes from a lot of reasons, they'll be more afraid. The factor that really matters is trust. And by the way, to drive this home, trust is by far and away the most important emotion in dealing with people in a contentious situation. The field that I practice is called risk communication. That's a lousy name, because it sounds like I just got to figure out what to say and which social media to use and how my website should look to educate people. What I'm really here preaching to you is respecting the emotional component of the issue that you're dealing with. It's got facts too, of course. So that you treat people and their feelings with respect to maximize how much they'll trust you, and everything else, including your information, will have more influence. Where's the fellow who had the white cowboy hat on last night who's a county planner from County? La Platte. He told me a great story last night. He said, we talk to people, and the first thing we do when we walk in is we ask them. You tell the story better than I do, but it was, we asked them what were their concerns. Tell us what you wanted to know about. You weren't giving him any information, but boy, you were telling the amygdala, here's a guy who wants to listen to me, as opposed to, hey, we're going to have this information fair, and we're going to tell you all of what we think you ought to know. That's respectful of people's feelings. It changes the tenor of the relationship just on the handshake. That's, again and again and again, what I'm up here preaching and giving you some details on. Trust can also come from whoever is communicating about the risk. This is a real important one. A couple of years ago, I was out giving this talk. Kirby heard it. Thank you for inviting me back to COGA. And they were talking about going out into communities and communicating with people. And they asked me for some advice. I said, well, find the people who actually live in and are neighbors and friends of, or priests or doctors or whoever, trusted people in those communities. Don't send the PR person, the trained spinmeister, right? Or if your company makes a big mistake, BP spilled the oil and they had a big debate inside the company whether they should send the British head of the company over to do the talking, because a lot of their PR people knew that he kind of came across like a stiff. And the number two guy was from Louisiana and had the accent and knew about shrimping and everything. But with that size spill, who should apologize? Who can apologize? The head guy, right? Because of that, the importance of that, the number two guy can't apologize for that big a mistake. That's the question to ask about who should do the communicating and how you feel about, how you think people feel about you in the relationship. This consortium that you have working is a trust-building reality. That's why Keystone's model works, because it brings people in and validates, allows the validation of their concerns, and that then allows for constructive rather than combative solution seeking. Here's the second factor: risk versus benefit. So let me go forward a couple slides and just ask it this way. See that ladder on the right? That's a ladder in a dump truck, pretty jury-rigged looking thing. So I want you to all to raise your hand if you would do what that guy's doing, climb up that thing to change the light. Raise your hand. Nobody? Nobody at all? For $1,000? Well, so, keep your hands up. Watch this, I'm gonna get every hand up in the room, right? And now it's just a matter of price. Right? So what that is at first, all your amygdalas said, no way. I just changed your amygdala's view with that. You talk about mineral rights and property value and all that. That's that conversation. Mitigations, you know, is it bribing a community? Is it being fair to a community? It's giving them some benefit that comes with the risk. That's fair. That's real. That's part of how you just all did it. I do it. We all do all of them. Who uses your mobile phone when you drive out here in the long distances that are out here? I'm sorry. Wait, hang on. Let me rephrase the question. What's the law in Colorado for using a mobile phone when you drive? No texting. Well, that's like, don't drive stupid. But, you know, lots of people do it. And I'll tell you about it. But can you use a handheld phone? Yeah. All right. So that's actually cool. So, and I'll talk about that in a minute. Raise your hand if you use a mobile phone while you operate a motor vehicle. Look at my hands up. All right. Okay. Now, keep your hand up if you know that's a risky thing to do. Y'all get it, right? So why do you do that?
Convenience.
Benefit. It's a perfect example. I'm always using these real-world examples. You know you're engaging in a risky behavior, and your mind subconsciously goes, convenience, benefit, the boss is on the phone, my wife's on the phone, you know, social connection, whatever. That's the texters. You know, they can't be unconnected. But subconsciously, what's going on in their mind about engaging in a risk, deathly risky behavior is benefit outweighing the risk. We do lots of stuff all the time that's risky. Who's a Caucasian in here who goes out into the sun without protection on their skin for more than 15 minutes a day? Come on, y'all. Yeah, right? So that's that. I don't put it on because it's all gooey, you know, and it, when I start to sweat, it gets in my eyes and stuff. Taking a risk for a benefit. Or who really likes the nice glowy tan, right? That's another benefit, right? So this language. Uncertainty is a really big one, and a big one that's come up a lot in the hydraulic fracturing field. If you don't know what you need to know about the risk, you don't know how to protect yourself. There's stuff in this air that at a high enough dose would kill you. Not acutely, like on the spot, but significantly raise you. There's three things in every breath you're taking in this room that at a high enough chronic exposure overtime dose will kill you. That you can't smell, see, detect, taste. Okay, everybody with me now. Now take a nice deep breath of that potentially deadly air. There were three things in it that could kill you. How does that feel? Fine, because you know it's probably not going to kill you, and I'm just playing a game up here. But let's say I said it was a possible endocrine disruption, this thing, right? Or I said it was a VOC, a volatile organic compound, or it was nitrogen dioxide, or I gave it some kind of spooky name, right? Representativeness bias, chemicals, oh my God. You can get people to sign a petition to ban dihydrogen oxide. Cause of representativeness bias. So let's say I've told you that, you know, some spooky chemical sounding thing, which it's true. I could give you a few names of identified probable carcinogens in every breath you're taking in this room. How does it feel that you can't see, smell, detect it, that part? It'd be better if you could, because you'd know what to do to keep yourself safe. The not knowing is scary. The not knowing, you hear it about, we don't know yet. This is common with all kinds of risks, certainly in the environmental realm. We haven't done the studies yet enough. Doctor, you need to scoot, please. And thank you for being here. You hear it all the time, we don't know yet, and there hasn't been enough research and all that sort of stuff. That's invoking this fear factor to drive up the fear of that issue. Boy, it's true with vaccines. It hasn't been studied enough yet. I don't want to vaccinate my kid. Nonsense. It's been studied a lot. But you invoke that to make it feel scary, because when we don't know how to protect ourselves, we don't feel safe. There are three kinds of uncertainty, though. The one is the can't detect it. The next one is I don't understand it. So the doctor and I were talking about endocrine disruption. Anybody want to repeat back what I said about endocrine disruption? No. It's complicated science. And that means that even after I explained it to you all, and I didn't really explain it, you still may not completely understand it. How does nuclear power work? How do they do that genetically modified food thing? Even if I sit down, or you sit down with me, and we really try to help the person completely understand it, unless you got a PhD in everything, there's going to be stuff that you end up not knowing, not understanding. So complicated scientific issues, like some of the chemical issues involved in this, have an uncertainty factor. And then there's the third one. Science isn't sure. And I'm not sure what science is or isn't sure about in hydraulic fracking, but you're going to hear these things in your conversations with people, and you need to respect that they're informing how their amygdala is thinking about you and the whole issue. Control. I like to do this one. No, I'll start over here. You've had this experience in the long distances out here that you travel. You're driving along at night with a friend in the car, and you're going 75 miles an hour, and you wake up. Right? By the way, this is good for your cash flow, doctor, right? Yeah, okay, those people, right? And you've already tried the radio and the cold air and slapping your face and all that sort of stuff. So you say, hey, honey, can you drive? I'm falling asleep. And she says, fine. And you trust your friend's driving. So you pull over, you switch seats. Now you're in the passenger seat. Do you go right to sleep? Why not? Person with the bangs there. You're not sure that they're going to stay awake. What difference does it make? You just were asleep driving a deadly machine. Which could be worse? Right? Well, imagine this with me. I'm sure you've had this experience. Your foot goes to the imaginary brake pedal because the red lights in front of you look a little closer. Right? Or your hips try to steer the car. Right? Well, that's this. That's your amygdala going, I want the wheel of life to be in my hands. And if it's not under my control, what's happening to me is scarier. That's why stakeholder engagement, true stakeholder engagement, real decision-making input works besides trust, because that's like putting people's hands on the steering wheel. Real important, feeling of control. Here's a second one. It's corollary to control, but it's different. And it's the issue that's going to come up probably on your ballot next year. Local choice is, as I understand it, how it was framed, and is local choice and setbacks. But local communities should have the right to be able to say, similar to the environmentalists who want to ban kill genetically modified food, and the way they're doing it now is saying the companies should label it because consumers should have choice. Man, if you ask anybody in any survey, do you want choice over anything? We're all going to say, yeah, because, right? That's safer. So imagine this with me. You're using your mobile phone when you drive. You're in the car. Yesterday, here's a confession. Yesterday, I came up from Grand Junction. It was a beautiful sunny day, and the sun in the west is glowing on the mountains. I'm driving, taking pictures. I give this lecture, all right? So we're all animals. I sent the pictures. My wife said, how did you take that picture? You know, it's got the highway right in the middle of it. So imagine this with me. You're driving, you're using your mobile phone, you're talking, it's a casual conversation, and you look over and there's somebody next to you in their car or truck on their cell phone, and they're speeding up and slowing down and swerving a little, and that pisses you off. Am I right? Besides that, I just said a semi-dirty word. Am I right? Have you ever had that experience? Well, wait a minute. The statistics say you should be way more afraid of you doing it to yourself. 4 times more likely to hurt yourself operating a mobile phone, handheld or hands-free, than somebody next to you is gonna. Do you think that people all over the country have asked states to ban my mobile phone when I drive? You think they're saying, hey, ban mobile phones when you drive, including Kirby's or whoever's is ringing. You think they're saying ban mine? What are they saying? Because of that. Because a risk that's imposed on you feels worse. And this is directly relevant to your issue. A risk that's imposed on you feels worse. That's why finding ways to work with, as opposed to imposing on, communities any kind of a risk changes the emotional dynamic big time. And as I say, it's relevant to your issue, but it's relevant to lots of others. Well, here's another one that's relevant to all of yours. Huge. So I changed my slide after the conversation this morning. So endocrine disruptors are basically industrial chemicals or natural chemicals that work like hormones in your body. And they turn systems up or down, like hormones do, only extra, beyond what your normal body should be doing. So that's not great. It's particularly not great and suspected of being harmful to the developing fetus, which is sensitive to tiny, tiny levels of this. Okay? And they found a lot of evidence in wildlife that suggests something may be up, enough so that the EPA and lots of other agencies and universities are now studying, could some of what we're exposed to be endocrine disruptors, hormone interferers? But what's really interesting is soy is Has anybody ever heard of that? It's called bisphenol A or BPA or that thing in baby bottles and the plastic bottles. You all heard of that kind of somehow or other, right? Well, you all heard about that. You heard anything about soy being endocrine disruptor? So some, but more, shook their head for the plastic. And that's because the plastic has been the target of the environmentalists who are worried about the industrial chemical part of the risk. And I ask the leading advocates of this, I say, wait a minute, soy is 10 times more estrogenic to sample cells in a dish than this plastic thing. Why aren't you campaigning for more control on soy, knowing the reason that? Because natural is less scary. There are folks all over the country who are afraid of nuclear power and radiation, who go out into the sun with no protection on their skin. 12,000 melanoma deaths a year from the sun. It's natural, it's less scary. Huge issue for you all. Huge issue for you all. I'm going to stop, give myself a break, but play a little audio. We have to put the microphone next to the speaker. You got one back there?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, man, is he good?
The Wizard of Oz.
We couldn't plug in our microphone. So the lady you're about to hear from lives across the street from Three Mile Island. You all know what Three Mile Island was? The nuclear plant that had a meltdown but didn't actually release anything. Came close, scared the hell out of us, but didn't actually release radiation. But she's convinced it did. She was one of the evacuees. She keeps the cancer cases in her neighborhood. You know, the citizen epidemiologist, the map with all the pins in the map, look at these clusters. And she's still convinced that Three Mile Island caused those cancers, even though 25 years now of overwhelming evidence says that's not the case. But the other thing you need to know about this lady is she lives on a part of bedrock, for the geologists in the room will understand this, that's really rich in uranium. And you know what that means for the gases in her house? Radon. In fact, one of the most uranium-rich pieces of bedrock in the country. And it's called the Redding Prong. There's plenty out here. There's plenty of the White Mountains where I hike. You can take a Geiger counter. It goes off like a bastard. Yeah, there's plenty of places. Yeah, and Durango County's got the mines that may be coming back and the reprocessing. Same sort of issue. Same sort of issue. So she hasn't had her house tested for radon. This lady who's freaked out about what the evidence says Three Mile Island didn't do. I want you to listen to what she says about why.
Many Pennsylvanians, like Linda Brash, have been actively monitoring radiation from Three Mile Island since 1979.
Let me see if I can make a move. Okay, I'm going to start again. The slide, she's not talking.
Many Pennsylvanians, like Linda Brash, have been actively monitoring radiation from Three Mile Island since 1979. But have they had their own houses tested for radon?
I have not had my house tested. And perhaps I will someday, but I don't look at it as a... It's not a man-made thing.
There it is.
Radon is part of... seeps in through... It's in the dirt. It's in the... It seeps in through our homes. And we've been building homes for many, 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 many years. Where's my thinking wrong here?
That's the best part. Again, you can't see her face, so I don't know about the slide. So first of all, you hear her amygdala go, what matters to me is not the science on radiation. Right, so I'm not going to reach her with an education campaign on radiation. What matters to her is it's not man-made. She said it. It's not just these psychology studies that do this. It's us. That's why I keep teaching with these fun little examples of us. This is real life. She also says, second thing she says, we've been building houses forever and ever and ever. So that's another factor that I won't get to later, but I'll mention now. When we're familiar with a risk, it becomes less scary. You want to build a new well site? You take all the people around that who are worried what it's going to be like over time, not what during the construction phase, that has different issues, and you offer to let them talk to neighbors, take them to existing pads and operation sites, and let them on their own talk to neighbors around there. And what you do is you change in their mind what seems strange and foreign and new to them till we've lived with it for a while, and I bet that most people around most of these sites have gotten used to them. Maybe they don't like them, maybe they do like them, but they're used to them. That changes from new to familiar, and you heard that in her voice. But the third point that she said is the hope. I'm up here talking about how our decision-making is all clouded by by emotion and we're stupid. We're not. We can think. And she said at the end, where's my thinking wrong here? You could hear in her voice, wait a minute. Her rational brain is screaming to her amygdala, you dummy. Because, like, you know, you could almost hear her say, wait a minute, radon's a risk, and I haven't tested my house. What's up? We are also reasoning beings. We do use the facts. We use emotion more. But if you can build trust by showing respect for the emotions that are at work in your issue, you can get the thinking, reasoning, objective part of the brain more engaged in the conversation. That's relationship building and management. Stakeholder involvement, task forces, it has lots of names. This is the psychology of why that works. One last one of these psychological factors, and then I'm going to move on. Dread. So for this one, so it was very interesting when the doctor stood up. He said there were three bad things that could happen to you. One was injury, and one was death, and one was cancer. It had its own category. Yeah, because, wow, talk about representativeness bias when I say cancer, and God help us, we've all had experiences in our family. I'm showing respect for that, but it's particularly scary. Scarier, in fact, than bigger killers. So let me demonstrate that with you all. You have to die tomorrow. Good news, it's just an exercise. You get to pick how. You can either be eaten alive by a shark or die of cancer. Between the two, who votes for death by shark? Heart disease. Shark or heart disease? You can either die of being eaten alive by a shark or of some form of heart disease. I'm not telling you what kind. So who votes for death by shark? Because of, I've already picked on you. To get it done with fast, less suffering. Right, yeah, exactly right. I asked this once of a bunch of journalists, and a guy raised his hand. I said, why? He said, my obit would be on the front page. Risk versus benefit, right? You can see it all through this lens, right? Now, let me change it two ways. You can die in fire, flame, not even the smoke, and you get unconscious, and then you burn. Joan of Arc at the stake, flame, or heart disease. Who votes for death by flame? There's no head in the mouth. I never usually get any takers for flame. Let me change it one other way to make it very real to all of y'all. You can die tomorrow. The choice of how to die is either cancer or heart disease. Between those two, who votes for death by cancer? Look at the room. Look around, y'all. To the extent that you're actually participating with me here, you're all dumb. You're all dumb. You're all wrong. You're all wrong. Because in this demographic, you are all statistically way more likely to die of heart disease than cancer. So based on the statistics, we should be more worried about what's more likely to kill us. One in a million is a smaller risk than one in a thousand. You know, that whole education thing. You all made the wrong choice. But your amygdala helped make the choice. And dying in a way that involves a lot of pain and suffering is a worse way to become dead. It's not just, I will be dead. It's how I get there. It's scarier. That's why the medical profession's making a whole lot more money on screening and doing a whole bunch of stuff for cancer than for heart disease, which kills about 70,000 more Americans a year. Today, 2,000 people, 3,000 people. Unbelievable. 2,000 people. So that's the last of the psychology. Oh, there's a new and familiar. A real quick one, and then I'm going to sum up. Another subconscious field. So I was having a conversation with the former congressman over here who said if he had done his work well, there wouldn't be any Democrats left. Right? Sorry, you're on the spot. See, you're on camera the whole time. And he was telling me that he had a conversation with a congressman on the floor of Congress. He was new to Congress. He was worried about the safety in the neighborhoods in Washington because some of them aren't safe. And the congressman from Alaska said, nah, you can't carry a gun, but here's what you do. And they're on the floor of Congress with C-SPAN cameras, and he pulls out a Bowie knife from his boot on the floor of Congress. Yeah, so the reason I pick on you is just for this example. He and I would have a difference of opinion on that issue. But it doesn't have anything to do with politics. It actually has more to do with how we want the world to work. And we arrange ourselves in groups around the way society's rules should basically be. Politics is just a symbol of that, a way to have it work our way. But the underlying how we want society to work is really how we associate with friends, agree or disagree with people. And the reason this is relevant to all of you is that there are four groups in this field of what's called cultural cognition, and some of the most adamant opponents of hydraulic fractured drilling come from a couple of these tribes. And I'll explain now what those tribes are. And you'll find that we are all, myself included, in some of all of these tribes. It's not either or perfect, but what we do is we shape our views on the issues of the day so they align with the people who have the same general values as us. Not just religious, not just political, how society should work kinds of values, okay? And why do we do that for safety and survival, do you think? What would the value for my safety and survival be of agreeing with my friends on any issue? Any guesses? Why aren't you supposed to talk about religion or politics or what's the other one at dinner parties? Right? Because you won't piss off your friends, right? Why does it feel safer if you don't, if you agree with the tribe? Because if the lion walks in together, I got a shot. If everybody rejects me because I have the outlier position, I'm lion food. We have evolved to be acutely sensitive to agreeing with our tribes. I use the word tribe because it's when it started was that, and now we call them political parties, but it's kind of the same thing, right? So we subconsciously, see that red word? Subconsciously, see the facts on an issue and arrange them so that they end up with, poor man, so that they agree with our friends. Now let me describe to you the groups, because you'll recognize these in yourself, I do too, and in the opponents of this kind of resource extraction. They consider them on a continuum from one side to the other, so it has nothing to do with left or right here, it's just I'm starting here. One group's called individualists. I'm gonna guess there are a good many of you in here. I had a wonderful conversation with a fellow from Wyoming last night who had a lot of those values, which I share in some degree. An individualist means a person who wants to have more individual choice over his or her life, that's all. It's not bad, it's not good. It's just how you want your life and society and the rules of society to work. You're more comfortable with it working that way. You can manifest that in politics. You can manifest that in what other groups you join. You can manifest that in how in your groups decisions are made. You want society to work where the individual has more say in his or her own choice. I'm some of that on lots of issues. And on the other side are communitarians. They like a society where everybody's in it all together and we share the decision making, and yeah, the whole collective is the decider for the greater common good. So let's take an issue like gun control, probably a hot button issue here, right? So, you know, in the 1980s, when the people who wanted to do the Second Amendment thing took over the NRA, which used to be like a bunch of Republican duck hunters, and they made it that issue, that's fine, I'm not taking sides on it. They wanted it to represent a way to say society should work in a way that leaves me alone and lets me choose. That's individualist. Well, what do you think a communitarian thinks about gun control? What do you think they say? Let's give up some of the individual rights for the greater common good. Well, the greater common good guys happen to be located in Boulder. Just saying. Right? That we're all in this together worldview. And by the way, like I said, we're all some of both of these. We're all some of both of these. Of course we are. But if my tribe is full of people that say, well, let's take climate change. Here's another one. So the communitarian loves the idea of climate change in addition to the evidence, because can you fix climate change by yourself if it's real? Can you? I can't either. We're going to need everybody all in it together. Government intervention. They love the heck out of that kind of issue. And environmental issues like this one, right? On climate change, here's what happens in an individualist mind. And they've done this research. The individualist, to stay true to his tribal values of the government shouldn't butt into my life and other people shouldn't tell me how to run my life. Well, you can't admit that climate change is real. Because if you do, you're going to have to fight against your tribe, because the government's going to have to play a role, and the economy and the energy industry. External forces are going to have to. So what happens is, when you do research and you ask people a bunch of questions, how do you identify in these two groups? The individualists disproportionately don't agree with the scientific evidence in climate change, and disproportionately the communitarians do. But what's going on underneath is so that I agree with my friends in my tribe and not get kicked out. Two other groups. Hierarchists, I'll just start over here. They like a world that's stratified and predictable. Class levels, economic, social. There's old money and new money, this side of the tracks and that side of the tracks. They could even be on the wrong side of the tracks. They like a stable, predictable, unchanging, traditional world. I do too. Some of all of you may, right? Egalitarians hate a world that's so fixed in all these hierarchies that things can't change. They'll talk about justice, fill in the blank, economic justice, racial justice, environmental justice. Justice means fairness. Now, there's not a person in this room who doesn't think there should be fairness, generally, right? But when it comes to the government butting in to make it more fair, that's going to rile these guys because that's change. They asked hierarchists, assume climate change is real, and here's what the scientists say. The solution to climate change is strengthening the nuclear power component in our energy economy. And then they gave them another story that said all the same facts about climate change and said the one line that changed was, and dealing with climate change is going to require the government to intervene and make significant changes in the existing energy economy. That was the only line they changed. When you told them, the hierarchists, that the solution to climate change was strengthening a component of the existing economy, their denial of climate change went down. That's not the facts, that's the amygdala using all this stuff. And when you told them it's going to require government intervention and change, boom. That's a real complicated, powerful soup of emotions that are going into and butting against, in many cases, the objectivity of our brains with your data from the, you know, the studies and all the stuff you do and the facts. So, close with this slide. We have a few minutes of conversation. I said before that risk communication is a lousy name, and so is education. I had this conversation with somebody this morning for what you need to do when you're dealing with people in a contentious relationship, whether it's your husband or wife or stakeholders in a contentious issue. What a lot of research has shown now, and I'm not the only one who says this, is that what you need to do is prove by how you act. We're going to create an actual task force. It's going to have rules that say two-thirds vote, which means no one side's going to dominate. Prove by your actions. You haven't opened your mouth, but you've taken an action that is trustworthy and sharing control, right? By what you do, before you say anything, how you act, right? And then what you say. That's why if you call it risk communication, it just sounds like this part. You've left out how you walk the walk. Actions, messages, and any other interactions, hanging out with people, whatever, that demonstrate an understanding of and a respect for all of what I've been talking about. That it's not just about the evidence, and it's not about making them feel what you want to feel. And that approach will build trust and increase the influence you'll have in the dealings around the relationship, including if then you're dealing in the relationship, it's just giving you more facts and educating. But the educating comes after what you really want to do is build the trust. It's relationship management around risk issues that have all of this emotional stuff in it. I hope this is helpful to you. It's a rush deal. I've written a whole bunch of stuff that's online free, including chunks of this book on my website if you want to. Please call me if you have any questions. Not for money. I go around now, I'm serious. I'm lucky enough to not have to chase every penny anymore. And I go to places where I meet new people and make new friends and learn new issues and try to help. People getting along better is a better world for me. That's my group. So if you have any questions on any of your issues or any advice or anything you need, please figure that we've met and we've begun a conversation and we got a few minutes left and I'd be glad to take your questions. Thank you.